Yeah, we're fixing the video very quickly, sorry.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your the cross, I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave, your glory fills the highest praise. What can separate?
A time of offerings, and let's just say the offertory verse together, or not offertory verse, the
it is
offertory verse, sorry. Let's sing the offertory verse together.
Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there would not be room enough to store it. Malachi 3:10. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering.
Well, welcome everybody. Yes, thank you. You're welcome. We're glad to be able to worship together this morning. We want to share the peace of the Lord with each other. So let's greet each other and say peace, because Jesus said, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives." And so we welcome each other with the peace of the Lord.
Peace.
Peace of the Lord. I can't find my other view. There it is. Hi. Peace of the Lord, Ken. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's Joy and Gordon. Hi, Doreen. Peace of the Lord.
Peace of the Lord.
Peace of the Lord. Yeah. Hello, Joy.
Hi.
All right. A few announcements.
This is Joshua.
We are.
I'll turn this off.
This is. Okay. We're in to the full swing of February now. Yesterday we had the fun day. If you came, I hope you had a great time. There's lots of food and fun and all kinds of stuff like that. And that was really enjoyable. And we were raising money for the church. So it was great to have all that support. And just thank you everybody who helped out and showed up and stuff like that. That was really wonderful. Next slide, please. Just want to highlight our upcoming events. Ash Wednesday will be a Sunday service. So next week we will have Ashes. It's the beginning of Lent. Obadiah will be preaching. So that's next week. And then in March 10th, we've got Levite Sunday. So the kids are going to be getting ready over the next month, preparing for that worship, and they've got something special, family lunch. And then there's also going to be an info session after family lunch around 2 o'clock or so, 2 to 3, about getting involved with sponsorship. We're already getting some things rolling. I've been talking to Gary a little bit, just sort of figuring out the education side of things for them. And if you're interested in helping out with that, or with driving them, or helping them get, if you have any expertise or just interest in helping, you don't have to be an expert in helping them, you know, get connected with family doctors, dentists, driver's license, all kinds of stuff like that. Please come to that session, and we would love for people to help. And it's not like a short-term commitment. It is for a full year, but it doesn't mean that it's all on you for the full year. That's the idea of having a team, is that we help each other out and we help them when they're able to come. Okay, next slide. Just continue to encourage you to give. I want to share with you, we had some encouraging, so if you go to the prayer item slide, actually, we had some encouraging news. We received a pledge that had been made. If you go to the green slide. Yeah, okay, we'll come back to that. There's a prayer slide. No? Ah, yes, the prayer slide. So we received $100,000 donation from TEC. So that part was had already been pledged, and that was indicated in our thing. But we also received a $25,000 donation. It's American. It's being held by our American partners. So an organization donated to us through them, and they're going to eventually transfer it over to us. So that'll be whatever the conversion rate will be. So I just want to tell you guys, like, God's resources are not small. You know, he's got abundance, and he's able to do this. And like, when we are generous, if you remember a little while ago, you know, the church council said, okay, we're going to give money away, even though we're raising funds and things like that. And it's like God turns back and says, like, you thought that that was a big amount of money, but I have much more that I can give you and provide for you. So construction stuff, all that stuff is going underway. And let's continue to pray for these things. I want to go back to that slide, camping. We want you to save the date. You don't have to like commit right now and give us your money or anything like that. We'll talk about that when we get closer to date, but we would love for you to save the date. It will be the Canada Day weekend. We're going to go for 3 nights, 4 days, 28th to the 1st at Coco Hollow Campground. If you can't make it for the whole weekend, come for part of it. But we would love for you to make that, set that aside. We've already made a number of, we've booked a number of campsites already. I think, how many campsites did we book? Six, was it six or was it eight? Anyways, we booked a number, 6 to 8. I don't remember how many we booked. I think we booked 6 at least. So that means that we're holding those, and then basically if you want to come, then we'll like put you in one of those campsites, and we just have the reservation already on hold. So please put that in your calendars if you're interested. If you've never come, we would love for you to join with us. It's been a lot of fun the past couple years going. We go hiking, we go to the lake, and we share lots of meals together, and that's really a great time, cooking lots of crazy foods, especially the young adults like to bring lots of intense things. All right, next slide. We would love for you to help bring snacks. So thank you to Jamie today and Abel, who brought, well, he's saying it's mostly Jamie, but Abel had to carry it in. So thanks to both of you. They brought these lovely, delicious cookies. If you would love to help out with snacks, we would love to have you do that. And you don't have to be like, oh, I'm not a baker. It's like, hey, if you would like to buy a bag of chips and share it with everybody, we would love for that too. We used to, upstairs when we used to meet up in the multi-purpose room, we had a drawer, a snack drawer, with a few different bags of chips and things like that. So if you would like to help out, no pressure, but if you would like to help out, we would love for you to do that. And you can feel free to bring in some snacks to share with each other. And it's just sort of fun to gather around the table and around food. Okay, let's take a moment to pray right now. Pastor Christine isn't here this morning. Harmon isn't here because they're sick. Well, Harmon is the one who's sick, and then Pastor Christine is starting to feel sick, so we can pray for them as well. Let's pray right now. So Lord, we lift up to you Pastor Nasir and his family as they get ready for their medical exam. We just ask that you would be with them as they wait for that, and as they prepare for, well, they can't really prepare that much, but we just ask that they would pass that exam. Lord, we pray for those who are sick amongst us. We pray for Pastor Christine. We pray for Harmon. We also pray for Grandpa Sam Bao, who is, he's just had his health problems as well. We pray for your healing mercy over them. Come, Holy Spirit, come. And Pat's shoulder, Grandma Pat's shoulder as well. So we pray for healing for them and for anybody else among us who is sick or is experiencing pain. Holy Spirit, come and bring about healing. You're the one who's able to do this. You're the one who can bring about healing in all of our bodies. So Lord, we invite you to do that. We pray for our construction and demolition, for safety for all the workers. We pray for our finances. Lord, thank you that you are the provider and you will continue to provide. So we invite you to do that in our lives and in our church. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right, let's stand together for the Apostles' Creed, which reminds us of our faith in the greater story of the Bible. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He becomes the judge of the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So please remain standing as Shelley comes to read the gospel.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud. This is my beloved son, listen to him. And suddenly looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of our Lord.
You may be seated. Let's pray. So God, we invite you into our hearts this morning as we reflect on your word and invite you to speak to our hearts what you have to say to us about who we are and who you've created us to be. So Holy Spirit, be at work in our hearts, we pray, that we would know you and love you and obey you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today we are wrapping up our series in the book of Joshua. Next week we'll be entering into a Lenten season, so we'll be preaching out of the Lenten passages in our lectionary. If you don't know what a lectionary, it's basically a series of passages that we read through as a church, and the global church, many churches in the world follow the same sort of rhythm and pattern of reading through scripture, and it follows different seasons of the church and different passages, and so we'll be doing that once we begin Lent. But today we wrap up in Joshua 24. So we jumped many, many chapters in between. There's so many things that happened in the book of Joshua. Exciting things, crazy things that happened. They took many other cities. They were deceived by people who dressed up as if they were from far away. You know, the sun and the moon stayed up in the sky. Like, there, lots of things happened. And at the end of all of this, we come to Joshua 24, and Joshua's old. And now he's sort of passing on both the Lord's words to the people as well as his own words. And so we're going to read from 24 verse 14, and then I'll sort of tell you a little bit about what's going on before and after the passage. So next slide, please. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your ancestors, the gods your ancestors worshiped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. And the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our parents out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites who lived in the land. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God. Joshua said to the people, you are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you after he has been good to you. But the people said to Joshua, no, we will serve the Lord. Okay. How many of you are familiar with the second half of verse 15? Anybody have that sign up in their house? I had a plaque on the wall above the dining table. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It was my grandfather's key verse, on my gonggong's key verse, and it was his dedication of himself and his family to the Lord. So, kids, we got a worksheet today for you. And I was thinking about that, you can use the front, you can use the back, but I would like for you to think of what are some ways that your family loves and serves the Lord together. So you can draw a picture of that if you want, or write it down. What are some ways that your family loves and serves the Lord together? And you can do the rest of the worksheet as well. Okay. So like I said, we're going to take a look at some of the other verses in this passage, because the opening verses of Joshua 24, he actually, Joshua gathers all the tribes to him at Shechem, and he summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of Israel, and they presented them before God. And then he says to all the people, and basically then he goes and he begins to recount the story of God with his people up to that point. He starts, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago, your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the Euphrates and led him throughout Canaan and gave him many descendants." So you remember that episode? That's Genesis, starting in chapter 12, right? God calls Abraham, then called Abram at the time. He hadn't been given a new name yet. But he calls him, and he makes promises of blessings to him, right? God says, "I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, as the sand on the beach." God says, I will make you a blessing for all the peoples. All the peoples of the world will be blessed through you. I will give you this land in which you dwell. This will be your promise. And then God says, "I gave him Isaac, and to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I assigned the hill country of Seir to Esau, but Jacob and his family went down to Egypt. Then I sent Moses and Aaron, and I afflicted the Egyptians by what I did there, and I brought you out." So remember the plagues. "When I brought your people out of Egypt, you came to the sea, and the Egyptians pursued them with chariots and horsemen as far as the Red Sea. But they cried out to the Lord for help, and he put darkness between you and the Egyptians." So remember, he brought the cloud around behind them and encapsulated the Egyptian army so they couldn't just charge them. They were enshrouded in darkness. "Between you and the Egyptians, he brought the sea over them and covered them." So they crossed over, and then after, when the Egyptians tried to cross as well, it collapsed over them. "You saw with your own eyes what I did to the Egyptians. Then you lived in the wilderness for a long time." And we remember why that happened, because they sinned on the edge of the promised land, right? "Then you crossed the Jordan." Oh, sorry. "And then I brought you to the land of the Amorites, who lived east of the Jordan. They fought against you, but I gave them into your hands. I destroyed them from before you, and you took possession of their land. When Balak, son of Zippor, the king of Moab, prepared to fight against Israel, he sent for Balaam, son of Beor, to put a curse on you. But I would not listen to Balaam, so he blessed you again and again, and I delivered you out of his hand." That's the donkey guy, in case you don't remember that, the talking donkey. "Then you crossed the Jordan and came to Jericho. The citizens of Jericho fought against you, and so did the Amorites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hittites, Girgashites, Hivites, and Jebusites. But I gave them into your hands. I sent the hornet ahead of you, which drove them out before you, as also the two Amorite kings. You did not do it with your own sword and bow, so I gave you a land on which you did not toil, and cities you did not build, and you live in them and eat from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant." That is what the Lord has done. Joshua recounts this not out of his own telling, but out of what the Lord has said. This is who God is. God is the one who prepared the way the entire time. God is the one who made the promise from the very beginning. God is the one who led. God is the one who delivered. God is the one who saved. God is the one who conquered. God is the one who provided. All those things were what the Lord has done. So it's amazing when you think about it, when you really reflect, right, of what the Lord has done. And you say, wow, God has done so many miraculous things. He's done so many things that would not have been possible except that he did them. Right? We talked about this last week. It's not possible for them to do it. And especially the way that he told them to do it. It's even more impossible, right? To walk around a city for 7 days and on the seventh day to walk around it seven times. It's just insane. It looks literally insane. And yet God is the one who does these things. He takes the unexpected, the ridiculous, and he says, "By my hand and by my power, you will knock down the walls." Well, actually, "I will knock down the walls and you will conquer the city. You will walk across a sea on dry ground." you will enter in to the promised land. That's who God is, and that's what he has done. Do we remember what he has done for us? Do we think about that? A while ago, I think I mentioned this, but I'm going to bring it back up again. Just sort of reflecting on our development process, right? And I mean, I wasn't even here when the first sort of development ideas were being hatched. That came before me. So that's kind of crazy because I've been here for many years now, right? So even before that, people were already praying and discerning and feeling God was calling us to find a space, a home, a place. And we looked at so many different locations, right? On Number 5 Road, we looked at many numerous locations. We looked at different office buildings and properties all over Richmond. And God has led us to this point because of what he has done. You know, in those moments, we had some big fights over money, over decision-making in the church. And a lot of questions were asked, like, how do we know for sure this is what God is doing and how God's being at work? And sometimes every time it didn't work out, it seemed like it was a failure. You know, it seemed like, oh my gosh, you know, we thought it was going to be this golf course that was going to get subdivided, or it was going to be that empty property, that farmland, or it was going to be this church that's being sold, or that office building and whatever. And each time, and we were raising money and the whole time through, but each time it just sort of felt like, oh, are we really doing this? God, like, where are you? We felt like this is it, but it wasn't it yet. And yet in the midst of it, God was also preparing. God was also providing. God was also getting us ready, right? If you think about when we purchased that unit, those three units, like, it's remarkable that we had basically all the money already in hand, sitting in our development fund, right? Like, that's kind of a crazy thing to think about, that it actually required all of the giving that had happened up to that point. And some of those properties were much more expensive than what we had, and we would have had to raise a lot more money to purchase them, let alone build on them. And yet we get to this one point, and it's like the money almost perfectly matches, right? It basically did what we had and what we were purchasing. It just worked out that God did that. But we couldn't have seen that in the moments when we were looking at whatever golf course building, right? We didn't know that was coming. We didn't know that this was what God had the plan for. We didn't, even in the midst of trying to get these three units while we were still going through, we didn't know that that was going to be the finishing thing. And yet God is able to do that. God did that, right? That's what the Lord has done. And I'm just talking about the building. That's all I'm talking about there. But think about all the other things that God has done in terms of how he's shaped our hearts, how he's shaped us as a people. You know, it's a cool thing to be able to grow up and see people grow up in the church, right? I like to joke with Lucas about how much he's changed since I first showed up. When he was in grade 7, and I mean, you see this suave, confident young man, but when I first showed up, Lucas, if you don't mind me saying, Lucas used to bail out of our group every single time he was like the focus of attention. So we'd play games, right? We'd play games with like a pool noodle and we'd bonk people. And if he got bonked, he'd run out the room and be like, Lucas, it's your turn. And he'd be like, he'd just like take off. Or it's like we'd share and then we'd get around the circle and it was like Lucas' turn. And like Luca would just like, he'd just like disappear. That's excellent. So he was more comfortable in smaller settings. But at the time, I'm just saying you've grown a lot. You've changed a lot. That's what I'm saying. Okay, that's my point. That God has done a great work, not just in Lucas, but in so many of us. Being able to see children grow up, young people grow up, seeing ourselves grow and change to learn to know God more, to love him more, right? I mean, I couldn't have imagined Athan getting married when I first met him. Like, we were making really dumb jokes and farting in the stairwell and stuff like that, you know? Like, that's You don't think about those things at the time, but God has done these things, right? God has done these things. If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't be who we are now, and we wouldn't have seen and experienced all the things that we have, right? All the things that we take in our lives that are gifts, those are things that God has done. Remember that he's the one. Now, I don't know for those of you parents with your children, you know, I don't know how often you spend remembering things or telling the stories of what God has done in your family, right? Bishop Silas, he'll tell stories about like when he was a kid and grandma, you know, or his mom and grandma, you know, they would be praying and all these kinds of things like that and seeing God at work. I think it's important for us in our families to be telling the stories of what God has done for us, right? We remind our kids, especially the younger ones, about how God provided it for us in terms of being able to get a home. Or Tabby and Mommy were in a car accident, but they were safe. You know, you got to remember these things and remind ourselves of what God has done. Because they help us put life in the proper perspective. They help us focus on who is the most important, and that is God. So that's my first thought, what God has done. Next slide, please. And then Joshua comes, and he says in verse 14 and 15, he says, "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshiped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable for you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Joshua reminds them that even though God has done all these things, it's not like we've been perfect through this whole process. It's not like we've been faithful to God in this whole thing, right? Abram and his family worshiped idols. Now, Abram and Sarai came and they worshiped God. But if you remember, Jacob goes to his uncle Laban, and he marries the two daughters, Rachel and Leah. And when they leave Laban to come back to the promised land, what does Rachel bring with her? Some of the family idols. She hides them in the camel, whatever thingy, the saddle, and she sits there and she's pregnant and, or she's not feeling well. I don't know, she's not pregnant yet. She's not feeling well and she's like, "I can't get up," but they're like in her saddlebags. And so he doesn't check the saddlebags, but they brought idols with them from beyond the Euphrates. Those might have stayed with the family, right? They went down to Egypt and they learned about the idols, right? Aaron makes a golden calf like the idols. Now, I mean, Moses destroyed that golden calf and made them drink the water, but they would regularly in the wilderness, in their wandering, complain to God and say, "Wasn't it better back in Egypt where we had food?" You know, and they forgot about the slavery part, you know? And wasn't it better there? We could just worship those gods. We could just eat that food. Because the truth is that in terms of God's relationship with people at that time, it was still a new thing, right? God had just given the commandments to Moses. They hadn't really been shaped as a people in terms of the worship of God. They didn't have all the life rituals, right? This is only a generation into being forming the tabernacle and having the priests lead the people into worship. So they're getting into what the lifestyle of worshiping God means. But it's evident from what Joshua is saying that there are some people who are still worshiping the old gods, either the gods from beyond the Euphrates or the gods of Egypt. And so he's saying, no, you can't keep on doing that. You can't have a divided heart. You must choose. You must choose. He exhorts them. He encourages them. He says, fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away those gods. But if it seems undesirable to you, if you don't want to, then you got to choose. You got to decide. Are you going to serve those idols? What are you going to do? Who are you going to be? You have to make a choice. That is the freedom that God gives each one of us. Right? One of the questions that I grew up wrestling with was like, oh, why doesn't God just like force me to like believe in him and then I don't have to like worry about that stuff? But it's like, no, out of God's love for us, He gave us, his image bearers, the ability to choose. Because when we are able to choose, then we're able to love, right? But we're also able to choose not to love, not to serve, not to obey, right? If I controlled all of my children in everything that they did, do you think that they would really love me? Or would they resent me? Children? Depends on what you made. I made you do. I know that I would resent. And I did resent whenever my parents did make me do stuff that I didn't want to do. You know, even if it was good for me or whatever. I had resentment. I had bitterness. I had anger. Those are normal human responses. But God invites us to choose love, to choose to serve, to choose to obey. We demonstrate our love by choosing to serve and obey him. So he says, you need to make a choice. But then Joshua says, but as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Now, in those days, in the ancient world, families functioned as whole units. Now, we live in a culture where it's a lot more individual choice and the individual, but they sort of functioned in family units in terms of choice and in a lot of under the direction. So if you think about like where, okay, this is a side conversation. I'm not going to get too deep into this, but like one of the reasons why we do child baptism is based on the jail, what was the guy? The jailer, right? Paul and Silas are in prison. The earthquake comes. The jailer is like, everybody escaped. I'm going to kill myself. They're like, no, everybody's here. He's like, what? Let me believe in Jesus. And then his entire household is baptized, young to old, because family units function together in the ancient world. And so Joshua dedicates both himself and his family. We will serve the Lord. He devotes them to God. He says, even if you choose not. And to be honest, if you look at the next chapter in the Bible, the next few chapters, guess what? It's the book of Judges. They stop serving the Lord over and over again. And it's a downhill, down a deep, dark hole through the book of Judges. But Joshua says, no, I'm going to dedicate my family to the Lord. Do you guys know the famous Proverb chapter 3, 5 and 6? Oh, no, wait, that's not the right verse. I just remember the wrong proverb. No, I was thinking about the proverb about train up a child in the way they will go. And then what's the end part? When they are old, they will not depart from it, right? That parents are called to raise up their children in the path of Jesus, in the way of Jesus, so that they know the path. Not just that they're dictated to the path, but that they would know who the way is, that they would know Jesus, and that they would find that there is love and life from God in that path. And so that when they're old, that they know and they experience the love of Jesus, and they've seen their parents living out their faith in a real way, tangibly, and not just their parents, but also other people in the church family, right? Because even if you don't have children, you serve an example, older ones, for the younger ones. Just so you know, they do look to you. They don't just look to their own parents. And so live your life in such a way that you direct the path of those who are around you so that they see that you have life and that you have love of God in your life and that what it looks like to serve him. We will serve the Lord. What does it look like for us to serve God? What does it look like for you and I to serve God in our workplace, in our schooling, to give up our time for him? What does that look like? Well, give up our time on Sundays, give up our time on a weeknight maybe to be part of a small group, to be in a more intimate community, give up our time to be with the Lord each day in prayer and in his word. Give up our energy to do the things that God calls us to do. You know, thank you to all those who volunteered yesterday or came on Thursday night to help set up chairs. you know, or run stations and things like that. It takes energy to do that. It gives up. What about giving up our money and offering up our sacrifices to the Lord? It's pleasing worship to him, right? Being willing to do those things leads us into his life because it requires to give up of our own. Do you see that? That we are required to give up of ourselves, just as Jesus gave up his life for us. God calls us to give up of ourselves so that we might receive more of him. It's only when we learn to obey through sacrifice and serving others that then we are able to receive more of who he is, his presence, as well as his character in our hearts. So what does that look like for you? Whether you're single or married, whether you have kids or not, what does that look like for you to serve the Lord and to show that life that you have to the people around you? What are the practical ways that you're called to do that? Maybe it's in your language. Maybe you have a potty mouth, or you're just overly negative with your attitude and your words. And maybe God is saying, hey, I want you to speak words of joy, speak words of encouragement, speak words of blessing to others, and not be cursing, but rather blessing. Maybe that's what the Lord is saying. Maybe God is saying, hey, you have time. Give it to others. Be a blessing to others. Spend time with them. Serve them, whether they're strangers or people familiar with you. Use your time for me. Whatever it looks like, are you willing to serve the Lord? Are you willing to invite him in and allow him to lead you into what that looks like? Let's pray. Well, God, we confess that it is not easy, that we are actually really much, very much like the Israelites, that we are full of good intentions and words, but we actually find it really difficult to follow through in serving you, in loving you, and worshiping you. So God, have mercy on us and forgive us that we're just not great with that. But thank you that you do have mercy. Thank you that you do give us new chances and you set us, give us a new page to write and create on each day of our lives, that we can follow you afresh and that we can be made new by your Holy Spirit. So come, Holy Spirit, come. Remind us of who you are, how much you love us, and the things that you call us to do and who you call us to be, as we serve in your kingdom and join with your big story, the things that you are doing in our lives and in the lives around us. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right. Well, I invite you kids to come back and sit with your parents now as we have our time of confession and then of Eucharist. So yeah, you can come back, leave the table now, and you can come back and sit with your families. All right. All right, thank you, kids, for coming back to your seats. Let's say our prayer confession. I want to invite all of us to say the words today, so we'll all say the words in white. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world, and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. We have heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. We have not loved you with all our heart, nor our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand up together. Is the Father with us?
Yes.
Is Christ among us?
Yes.
Is the Spirit here?
Yes.
This is our God. We are his people. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and our delight to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, living God, supreme over the world, creator, provider, savior, and giver. From a wandering nomad, you created your family. For a burdened people, you raised up a leader. For a confused nation, you chose a king. For a rebellious crowd, you sent your prophets. In these last days, you have sent us your Son, your perfect image, bringing your kingdom, revealing your will, dying, rising, reigning, remaking your people for yourself. Through him, you have poured out your Holy Spirit, filling us with light and life. Therefore, with angels, archangels, and all in heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Almighty God, owner of all things, we thank you for giving us your only Son to die on the cross for us who owe you everything. Pour your refreshing Spirit on us as we remember him in the way he commanded through these gifts of your creation. On the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Amen. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We are brothers and sisters through his blood. We have died together. We will rise together. We will live together. Therefore, Heavenly Father, hear us as we celebrate this covenant with joy and await the coming of our brother, Jesus Christ. He died in our place, making a full atonement for the sins of the whole world, the perfect sacrifice once and for all. You accepted his offering by raising him from death and granting him great honor at your right hand on high. Amen. Jesus is Lord. This is the Feast of Victory. Hallelujah. As Jesus taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So now please be seated. And we invite all of you who've been baptized, whether here at Richmond Emmanuel or at another church, to take part in the communion. If you haven't yet been baptized, you can come up and fold your arms and I'll pray a blessing over you. And just invite you to continue to be reflective as you wait or after you've received. Let's stand up again. And say the prayer, the post-communion prayer. Almighty God, Holy Father, we have sat at your feet, learned from your word, and eaten from your table. We give you thanks and praise for accepting us into your family. Send us out with your blessing to live and to witness for you in the power of your Spirit through Jesus Christ, the firstborn from the dead. Amen. Let's point to the cross. All our problems, we send to the cross of Christ. All of our difficulties, we send to the cross of Christ. All the devil's works, we send to the cross of Christ. And all of our hopes, we set on the risen Christ. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's please remain standing for our closing song.
Thank you.
church, may we be people who shout out his praise in our words, in our thoughts, in our actions, that others would know that we have the life of God because we serve him with our families, with our church family. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I heard that there are several birthdays, either today or yesterday or the day after. If you've had a birthday either in the last couple of days or coming up really soon, Owen is tomorrow, Andre was yesterday. Wow, okay, can we all sing happy birthday for them? Oh, and Amy's birthday too. Amy's birthday is today? And Amy's birthday is today, okay. Here we go. Happy birthday to you.
Woo!
Happy birthday
to you.
Happy
birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Awesome. And we have leftover fish balls instead of cake, so go have some fish balls.
Fish balls. Oh, they're having fish balls. Bye bye, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, Josh. Bye. Thanks. Great service.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Bye. So this will be the end of the recording. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye, Joy. Bye, Doreen.